So, what is an IT defining guy like me doing at an IT Agile conference? I don't think I'm here because I've actually been heading up an IT project back in the late 80s. And it took me 20 years to realize that what we were trying to do at the time was to run that project in an agile way. We succeeded, but it was very hard work, and I said, never again an IT project. And I kept that promise. I think the reason I'm here is that Agile is great and you guys want to scale Agile, which I fully support. But I don't think Agile can be scaled using directly the Agile framework, the Agile language, because most executives, they don't get it. Apology, a lot of executives, they think that Scrum is some kind of skin disease. So this is where Beyond Budgeting is coming in, because Beyond Budgeting is actually Agile on enterprise level, and we can help each other in scaling Agile. So that is basically what I'm going to talk about today. What is Beyond Budgeting and how does it fit into Agile? There it is. So, I work for a company called Statoil. I'll come back to that in a minute. When I joined Statoil back in the early 80s, it was a smaller company than what it is today. And not more companies, they want to grow. They want to become bigger. Fair enough. Many succeed, but many discover that we have not only become big, we have also become bureaucratic, rigid, inflexible. We've lost a lot of that agility, flexibility we had as a smaller organization. This is just like the aging process of man. As we grow older, we do lose a bit of that ability, agility we had as teenagers. And I have some personal experience here. And when it comes to man, we have no choice. That's the way it goes, whether we like it or not. Organizations, however, they have a choice. Because it's written nowhere that because you are big, you should be slow, rigid, bureaucratic, and all this stuff that we don't want to be. So our journey at Statoil has very much been about how can we find our way back to what we had as a smaller organization without losing the benefits of being big. So how can we be small and big at the same time? Now, what I want to share with you today is first the case for change. What problem with what I call traditional management? I don't need to spend a lot of time on it because you guys get it. When I talk to finance people, I need to spend quite some time talking about what's the problem. Then I've got some slides on this stuff called Beyond Budgeting. It is actually a somewhat misleading name because the purpose of Beyond Budgeting is not necessarily to get rid of budgets. The purpose is to create organizations which are more agile and more human. In order to do that, we need to change traditional management, and at the core of traditional management, we find the budgeting process and the budgeting mindset. So that's where the name is coming from, but as you will discover today, there is a lot more to it than budgets. Then we shall spend some time talking about how we are trying to do this at Statoil. And I'm saying trying because even if everything I will talk about is decided, it's written into what we call the Statoil book, that does not mean that this has reached every head and every corner of Statoil. This takes time. This is quite painful for a number of managers. And I'm not going to stand here and share a kind of glossy, sanitized story about how great we are. This is difficult. We have made mistakes. We have had detours. We have stumbled. But that is what real change is about. Real change is actually a bit messy and should be a bit messy. I would like to start with this wonderful quote from D. Hock, the founder of Visa. Simple, clear purpose and principles give rise to complex, intelligent behavior and the other way around. That is one way of framing what Beyond Budgeting is about. Another way is to call it management innovation. Management innovation is about exploring new ways of leading in knowledge organizations operating in dynamic and competitive business environments. And I would assume that goes for quite a lot of the organizations present here. Management innovation is, by the way, it's not management of innovation. That's actually one of the problems. It's a great way to kill innovation, trying to manage it. There is an interesting paradox related to innovation because, you know, everybody loves it. We want to be in the forefront, leading edge, unique, when it comes to technology and product innovation. The moment you move to management innovation, is different. That's scary. And then the question is, well, we ask for best practice. What we really mean is, what's common practice? What is everybody else doing, right? And maybe we call the consultants to make sure that we are not doing anything stupid. And a consequence of this is that technology innovation, product innovation, is a very crowded place because everybody is doing it. Management innovation, however, is not yet a crowded place because it's scary. But that is good news for companies who are brave, who dare to face management innovation, because you can get just as much good performance from innovation as from technology and product innovation. And I will reflect more on this important word performance in a minute. I just to quickly share with you my budget problem list before we go back to talking about performance. It's a pretty long list, weak link to strategy, very time consuming, assumptions quickly outdated, and by the way, the price, don't even ask me, we don't have a clue, and nobody else have either. Budgeting can stimulate unethical behaviors, lowballing the gaming, the internal negotiations. Budgeting and budgets often creates illusions of control. Big problem, very dangerous. Budgets can force us to make decisions too early. We have to make these decisions in the autumn, the year before. And by the way, it's the annual detailed budgets I'm talking about, not so much project budgets, even if they have some problems as well. Budgets can also lead us to decisions being made too high up in the organization, which doesn't always improve decisions. Very often it's the other way around. Budgets can prevent us from doing things that we should have done because it's not in the budget. And the other way around, it can lead us to do things we shouldn't do because it is in the budget and it's spend it or lose it. There is an interesting accordion forecasting horizon related to budget processes. When we do budgeting, we want to understand 12 months ahead. When we're into the budget year, the horizon we're interested in becomes shorter and shorter the closer we get to year end before we suddenly get interested in 12 months again because it's budget time. So you have this in the forecasting horizon, which is not the biggest problem, but I find it a bit funny. Last but not least, I would argue that budgets are very often a very bad yardstick for evaluating good and bad performance. It's a narrow, mechanical, too financially oriented language for that important topic, what is good performance. Now, I've been sharing this list of problems with tens of thousands of managers across the world over the last 15, 20 years. And most managers, they agree with this problem list. At the same time, most organizations still continue with this stupidity, which I find a bit interesting, and it's quite a paradox. And it could be that these managers think about these problems as some kind of irritating itches, but not a symptom of a more serious disease of a bigger problem. They are dead wrong, because these are symptoms of a very big problem, which is actually also a paradox. Because this process that was invented 100 years ago to help companies to support to perform better, there was no ill will behind inventing budgets 100 years ago. And it probably worked well at that time, maybe even also 50 years ago, but no longer today, because the world has changed. I will come back to what has changed. So today, this process has become more of a barrier for great performance than a support for great performance. And that is a problem, a big problem. Now, back to this important word, performance. I would like to reflect on that word for a few minutes in a slightly different setting than organizations. I would like us to move into traffic. Because in traffic, we would also like to experience good performance when we drive to work or wherever. And my definition of good performance in traffic would be a safe and good flow of traffic. Somebody once said that it's about driving faster than everybody else. That is not my definition of good performance in traffic. Traffic authorities, they actually want the same. They want a safe and good flow, especially where there's crossing traffic. And here is what we often find put up by traffic authorities to create the safe and good flow. Two questions around the traffic light. Who is in control and based on which information? And of course, the one in control here is to program this light. Right? There's no high tech here, no sensors, so the one who programmed this light is the one that is in control. And where would that person be as you're waiting for that green light? well, maybe in the office programming the next slide, in bed if you're out driving at night, but the person would not be in the situation. Which information would this programming be based on? It would be based on some historical trends, maybe some forecasts about how traffic could develop in this crossing, but it would not be entirely fresh information as you are sitting there waiting for that green light, right? But again, the best of intentions. Is there an alternative to the traffic light with exactly the same purpose? The roundabout, definitely. Who is in control in the roundabout? It's us, as drivers. And based on which information? The biggest car, that's a good comment. I'll come back to that. Based on which information? Fresh, real-time, here and now information, right? So very different answers on the same questions. Could be interesting to compare these two ways of managing traffic. Which is most efficient? Well, it's actually been proven that the roundabout is more efficient. There are something underneath this metaphor that is very important, has to do with, I'll come back to that in a minute. Why is the roundabout more efficient? It has to do with access to fresh information, but you do have access to fresh information in front of that light as well. You can see what's happening, but what you don't have in front of that traffic light is the authority to act on that information, because that rests with somebody else. Which is most difficult to drive in? Well, it's the roundabout. And back again to organizations for a minute. Everything we are trying to leave behind at Statoil is, from a leadership point of view, much easier than the stuff that we know we're trying to do. But we can't go for the stuff that's easy just because it's easy. We have to go for the stuff that's good for performance, and sometimes that is a bit more difficult. Last question before we leave traffic, and I'll come back to these comments, because is it relevant to talk about values in this setting of traffic? This is one of my many leading questions today. The answer is yes. We sometimes talk about values-based management, and the opposite of values-based management is rules-based management. The traffic light is rules-based management. Red is stop and green is drive. We can always discuss yellow, but it is a very simple rules-based management system. And if there is a value set among drivers waiting for that green light, which is about me first, I don't care about the rest. That mindset, value set, is normally not a big problem in front of that light. But in the roundabout, me first, I don't care about the rest, is actually a big problem. Because in roundabout, we need to cooperate more. We need to interact with people in a very different way. We need a common positive purpose of wanting this to flow well. We have to interpret each other's intentions. So it is not enough with fresh information authority to act on it. You also need a positive values set. The label performance management, which I actually have in my title, but which I don't like, is highly relevant for the traffic light, but it's not relevant for the roundabout, because the roundabout is not about managing performance. I think our ability to manage performance today is much lower than what we like to think, but there are so much great things we can do when it comes to creating conditions for great performance to take place. And that is what traffic authorities is doing in the roundabout. By the way, performance management, this is very often what it feels like. There's not just one traffic light, there is way too many. Now, the roundabout is a more self-regulating way of managing. And I would argue that in today's business realities, organizations need more self-regulating management models for at least two reasons. The first reason has to do with our business environment, which has much more of what in the armed forces called VUCA. You might have heard that expression, V-U-C-A, volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity. If we take that VUCA seriously, it should have significant implications for how we design our management models compared to there's no VUCA out there, right? That should be quite obvious. The other reality we need to reflect on and take seriously is not external, it's internal, has to do with people. It has to do with asking ourselves, what kind of people do we generally think we have in our organizations? And one language for that discussion was invented by Douglas McGregor back in 1960, great book called The Human Side of Enterprise. He talked about Theory X and Theory Y. not generation X and Y came much later. Theory X, a negative view on people and what motivates people. A view that most people in an organization is a bunch of potential thieves and crooks, which all must be managed tightly and kept on leashes, because if not, we know what will happen. They will all run away, do a lot of stupid things, and spend money like drunken sailors. Well, that's the popular version. McGregor, he was a bit more polite, but I think that's what he meant. Then you have theory Y, very much the opposite view on people. A view that most people beyond, I mean, many are well educated, I mean, that there's a lot of competence that people want to perform, want to be involved, want to be listened to, want to be treated as adults. And again, we don't initially need to agree on what we mainly believe in, but it should be very easy to agree that if we mainly believe in X, it should have very different implications for our management models compared to if we mainly believe in Y. Now, if we combine these two realities, we need to reflect on and take the consequences of the world out there, people in the organization, then it could look like this. You recognize the two dimensions, and I would say that traditional management lies in this lower left-hand corner, and I'll come back to what I mean with traditional management in a minute. Just one more comment on X and Y. You might have understood that our sympathy at Statoil lies on the Y side, but every time I talk about X and Y, there are some faces popping up in my head. And I can see those guys right. Those names, those faces, belongs to colleagues of mine at Statoil that I definitely will put on the left-hand side. I think you need to keep a close eye on those. There might be a few names popping up, faces popping up in your heads as well, though, because those people, you often find some of them in all most organizations, but that is not the issue. The issue or the question is, do this guy, these guys represent a minority or a majority? Because if they exist but represent the minority, we cannot let base the design of our management models on minorities. If Y is our majority view, then that needs to drive the design, and then we need to find other ways to deal with these guys on the left-hand side. This is just like in a free society. We are not putting everybody in jail because someone has done or will do something wrong. We are all free citizens within certain boundaries. Now, the way out of traditional management goes through addressing both these dimensions. Leadership on the horizontal and our processes related to the business environment. And what we need to get out of is something that's very rigid, it's very detailed, it's very annual, rules-based micromanagement, centralized command and control, a strong belief in secrecy and sticks and carrots as a way to drive performance, to the extent we can drive performance. Now, there might have been a time where this was the right place to be. I'm not arguing that. There might still be places around where this is the right place to be. I'm not arguing that either. But for us at Statoil, that is a very, very uninteresting discussion, because we know that our business environment is up here with a lot of VUCA, and it goes way beyond the oil price. And we believe that most people is on the Y side. So we can't be down in that lower left-hand corner. We need to move up to the right. On the leadership side, we need to be more values-based than rules-based. This does not mean no rules. It simply means that the stronger you are on the value side, the less rules you typically need. We need more autonomy. In this VUCA world, there isn't always time to run 9 floors up to get that decision. Then it can be too late. And again, decisions aren't always improved by being lifted upstairs. We need more transparency. And this is good news for all the scared managers I've met over the years, who are afraid of leaving that rather comfortable corner down left, because they are afraid of losing. What do you think they are afraid of losing? Control. And that fear is real, because I can see it in their eyes. What they maybe don't understand is that a lot of those controls are nothing but illusions of control. But the fear is still real. So here's some good news for scared managers. Transparency can be a great control mechanism, a social control mechanism. There is a reason why thieves and crooks mainly operate at night, right? Because then it's dark, there's no transparency. Well, we do have some operating during daylight as well, but that's a different story. Here's a wonderful little story from Swiss pharmaceutical company Roche, quite big, quite traditionally managed. They did a very interesting experiment on transparency related to travel cost. In a pilot, they kicked out the travel budgets, most travel rules and regulations. What they implemented instead was full transparency. So with a few exceptions, everybody could see everything. If you traveled, to where did you fly, eat, sleep, cheap or expensive? Open for your colleagues to see, and vice versa. guess what happened with travel cost in the pilot versus travel cost in the rest of the company? Fell radically through a very simple self-regulating control mechanism, transparency. This was about tearing all pages in the rules book instead of doing the opposite. Last but not least, we need to get hold of that internal, intrinsic motivation in people that can move mountains if you really can mobilize it. Most managers, they believe in something called internal motivation, but here is wrong, because they think that if you then add the doses of external motivation on top of the internal motivation, for instance, an individual bonus, then you get more motivation. Well, let's look at what research is saying here. There's 50 years of research into this topic. Initially, research says yes. If three conditions are present, if there's little motivation in the job itself, if it's easy to count, and if quantity is more important than quality, then adding on external motivation like individual bonus works. So for catching rats, picking fruit, another kind of simple, a bit boring work, wonderful mechanism. But research goes on. When you move over to more complex work, where more cognitive skills are needed, where more teamwork is needed, then you lose this effect. Then very often the external motivation is zero. Very often it's negative. It eats of the internal motivation. It's called the crowding out effect. I wish more managers would read more than what they actually do. There are too many who think they have finished their education and they haven't understood that they risk being more finished than educated. So it's not only budgets I've lost my belief in over these 15, 20 years. You put individual bonus on that list as well. At Statoil, we have always tried to be a values-based, people-oriented company. So I'm not saying we're perfect, but it's important for us. This book says a lot about that topic. So our challenge was maybe more that we had management processes that had a different message. And it doesn't help to have these theory Y leadership visions if we have theory X management processes, because that creates poisonous gaps between what we say and what we do. So our job has very much been about changing our management processes to reflect what we say about people and values and leadership, and to make our management processes more VUCA robust. And here are some examples of things that you typically need to do. Typically, the detailed traditional annual budget needs to go because it represents so much of what you find in traditional management. More specifically, we need to think differently around how we set goals and targets. For instance, we need less what I often call 29.2 targets. What? This 29.2, anything above is good, anything below is bad, end of story. That is a very narrow, mechanical language. And it doesn't help that we hit 29.2 if our competitors are doing 30 or 35, and vice versa, as one example. We need more dynamics into our processes. Think about January to December, the fiscal year. That makes sense as a period for doing backwards-oriented accounting, tax report, and so on. But from a business point of view, it very often doesn't make sense. We need to organize these forward-looking processes more based on business rhythms, more event-driven and less calendar-driven. I'll give you some examples of what this could mean. And last but not least, we need a more holistic approach where we shall evaluate performance. We should first think about how we achieve those results. We need to think about values. We need to think about hindsight insights, all things we know afterwards that we didn't know upfront. Right? We call this a holistic performance evaluation. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is what Beyond Budgeting is about. Trying to move up in that upper right-hand corner by addressing both leadership and management processes in a consistent way in order to become more agile, more human, which is not necessarily a goal in itself, but it's very, very good for great performance in organizations, performance defined in the right way. A number of companies is on this journey in some form or shape. Here's an overview of some of them. Norwegian companies on the left-hand side, some other Scandinavian companies moving to the right, some US companies on the right-hand side, some other European companies in the middle, and some Asian, South American companies in between. And I could have spent the rest of the day talking about fantastic management innovation taking place in these organizations. We don't have the time, so I need to limit myself to two companies. Let's start with an IT company, Miles, down to the left. It's a Norwegian IT company. No budgets, no targets, no nothing. Of course, your PC is important. Of course, training and competence is important. Miles employees can buy whatever PC they want, change it as often as they want. They can attend whatever training they want, wherever in the world, as often as they want. There's no PC budgets, there's no training budgets, no nothing. The only thing the company requires is that when you have bought that PC, when you have returned from that training, you have to post the cost of what you did and the cost of it on the internet. So they use transparency as the control mechanism. And they have just one small concern around this control mechanism. Could it be too effective? Fantastic company. Their most important process is recruitment. They spend an enormous time on recruitment. They never take less than 10 references. When they interview, the management interview is about values, beliefs, communication skills, personality only. They don't talk IT at all. Management leaves that discussion about IT skills to other skilled IT people on board already, IT employees. And if the IT guy says, the employee says no, then they have the veto right. Doesn't help us what management says. If they say no, they have a veto right. The veteran, however, on this chart is the bank you find in the middle of the slide at the top, Swedish Handelsbanken, which today operates across Europe, between 800 and 900 branches across Europe. It's the fastest growing bank in the UK. Handelsbanken completely abolished budgets already back in 1970. Not as a goal in itself, just one of many things they did in order to become more agile, more human. And this bank has been sticking to this very different and agile way of managing for more than 40 years now, almost 50, so it could be interesting to look at how have they been doing over this period. Let's look at the facts. Handelsbanken has been performing better than the average of its competitors every single year since 1972. Handelsbanken is among the most cost-effective universal banks in Europe. Handelsbanken has never needed a bailout from the authorities because they messed it up. I can think of a number of other prestigious banks that at some point in time needed help because they messed it up. Handelsbanken, never. And finally, Bloomberg has rated Handelsbanken as the most solid bank in Europe. So an amazing performance with a very different management style. Again, it's very much about autonomy, transparency, a lot of delegation out to the branch. They call the branch is the bank. Everything else is about supporting the branch. They have no individual bonuses because they don't want anything that can disturb that interface between the branch and the customer and what kind of advices they give. They do have an individual common scheme, a bonus scheme driven by how the bank is performing versus other banks, which also gives everybody an incentive to help each other because that kind of increases that common bonus. By the way, that common bonus is not just a common percentage across the board for everybody. It is the same amount for everybody. So the one with the lowest bonus percentage is the CEO because he has the highest base salary. Now, Handelsbanken and some other companies inspired what became known as beyond budgeting in the late 90s, came around roughly at the same time as Agile, actually. And these are the 12 beyond budgeting principles. And if you compare this with the Agile manifesto, you will find a lot of similarities, a lot of the same thinking. I will not go through this in detail. I have talked a little bit about the left-hand side. I will talk more about the process side when we arrive at Statoil in a minute. But just a few reflections here. First of all, this is an attempt to create consistency between what we say on the left-hand side, what we do on the right-hand side. Two examples of the opposite typically find in organizations. It doesn't help that we on the left-hand side talk loud and warm about we and us and together and team if everything on rewards principle 12 is based on individual bonus. Right? One message on the left-hand side, another message on the right-hand side. Guess which one is strongest. Doesn't help that we talk equally loud and warm on the left-hand side about how fantastic people we have on board. We would be nothing without you, and we trust you so much. But not that much. Of course, we need detailed travel budgets. Principle number 12, just imagine, principle number 10, imagine what would happen without. Gaps between what we say and what we do, it's poison. Second message, these principles do not represent a management recipe. This is more a philosophy, some guiding. What this shall mean in your organization depends on what kind of business you're in, what kind of history you have, what kind of culture you have. And that is the way it should be. I don't like management recipes, because in a management recipe, somebody has done all the thinking for you. Your only job is to implement other people's thinking. I find that quite boring, but also quite dangerous. And I would say, watch out for making agile or agile techniques like Scrum into management recipes. That is a disaster. It's the spirit behind your approach, and then do whatever is right. When we started out in Statoil, we were a bit careful with showing these principles too widely, because it can scare people. For some people, especially finance people, this is scary stuff. So we started out in a less scary place. We simply asked ourselves, why do we budget? What's the purpose of that annual budget that we make every year? And we discovered that there are not just one purpose, but actually three different purposes. And I'll come back to that in a minute. I just want to share with you this Statoil introduction. This is us in a nutshell. And by the way, the gas stations that you see labeled Statoil has not been a part of Statoil for 3 or 4 years. We sold that business some years ago, that chain will now be renamed Circle K. So they were allowed to keep the Statoil name for a period, but they will get a new name now. All right, so what's the purpose of a budget? There are actually three different purposes. Organizations use budget to set targets, financial targets, or sales targets, or production targets. At the same time, this budget shall be a kind of forecast of what can next year look like in terms of financial capacity and cash flows and so on. And last but not least, the budget is a resource allocation mechanism, right? We use that budget to hand out bags of money, cost, investments and so on. In big organizations, we talk about millions of bags of money handed out each year. It might sound very efficient to do three things at the same time, just like a financial Kinder egg, right? But that efficiency has a big price, because there's conflicting purposes at play here. Let me give an example. Let's assume that we want to understand cash flow for next year. We start on the revenue side. We ask our salespeople, what's your best sales forecast for next year? But don't forget that the sales forecast that you now give me will come back to you as a sales target. And there's a nice little sales bonus linked to hitting that sales target. So what was that sales forecast again? Could it start to move? Well, you know that you're in the middle of negotiating your own pay. We shouldn't be surprised if that happened. I wouldn't necessarily blame the sales guy, because we're putting this guy in a difficult situation. Then we ask the same people, other people, what is your best cost or investment forecast for next year? But don't forget that this is your only shot at getting access to resources for next year. And I think it was 30% that we cut your number with last year. So what was that cost forecast again? Investment forecast? Could it start to move? And you know that this is your only chance? Of course it does. I see some smiling faces, but this is not funny. It's actually quite tragic. Not just because it destroys the quality of our numbers. It also stimulates what I would call unethical behaviors. Fortunately, there is a very simple solution here. At Statoil, we still do all these three things, but in three separate processes, because these are different things. A target is what we want to happen. A forecast is what we think will happen. Whether we like what we see or not, brutally honest, expected outcome. And resource allocation is about how do we optimize scarce resources in the best possible way? What does it take to make it happen? And this can be different numbers, done in different ways and sometimes at different times. And the beauty of separating is that this opens up a big, big improvement agenda. Then we can start to have great discussions around each of these three topics. How can we set targets that really inspire and stretch without feeling stretched, and that are more VUCA robust? And some actually end up saying, we don't need all those targets, or maybe just a few. How can we have a simple, unbiased forecasting process where we quickly get on the table a good enough set of numbers that we We don't need a million details, but we know we can trust these numbers because we have removed the reasons for gaming these numbers. And last but not least, how can we find better ways of optimizing scarce resources, which sometimes, or quite often, is money, but not always. And these are examples of how we now do it in Statoil. And how can we do all of this more event-driven and less calendar-driven? This is a great way to get started if the 12 beyond budgeting principles initially seems too big, because when you move into those discussions, you tend to kind of slowly come back to those principles, but in a less scary way. I will give you a few examples of what this can mean in practice. What you might wonder most about is resource allocation. Again, we have no cost budgets, no investment budgets. For projects, we have a very simple approach. The bank is open 12 months a year. Yes, whether you get a yes or no. So you can always forward a project for approval. Yes or no depends on two things. How good is your project against the criteria we have, and can we afford it as things look today? Right. So here is a parallel to continuous delivery. The annual budget is too big a batch. We have to slice it up and do this more continuously. For more operational costs, we have some other menus, methods, some tools. You can use, there might be some burn rate guidings, operate at the cost level in the range of 1,000. No details until something else is decided. There could be some unit cost target, benchmark unit cost targets, or in some cases, nothing at all. We only look at the actual cost numbers and trends, and if we are concerned about what we see, we look at the numbers and intervene if necessary. Let me give an example of targets, relative targets, VUCA Robust. These are the most important financial targets we have at Statoil. We think in relative terms. We think football. Our definition of performance is to do well against competition. The two KPIs here definitely have their weaknesses. That is not the point. The point is that we think in relative terms. And these two metrics also drive the common bonus scheme we have in Statoil. Most of our relative KPIs are actually internal, not external. So this could be platforms in the North Sea compared on safety, production cost, regularity, whatever. Let me then move to the process where all of this comes together, ambition to action. Three purposes: translate strategy, secure flexibility, and to activate values. If some of you have heard about a concept called balanced scorecard, this is a kind of hybrid between beyond budgeting and the balanced scorecard, but I have a very ambivalent view on the balanced scorecard, because used in the wrong way, it can be, which is very often the case, it is a great way to reinforce traditional management. We are trying to do the opposite. Let me give you some examples. There are some steps in this process. Looks like this. It starts with translating strategy into strategic objectives. What does success look like on a medium-term time horizon? Then we're trying to find KPIs that can measure that we're moving in this direction. The only problem with measurement is that measurement alone moves nothing. Nothing happens just because we measure. You don't lose weight simply by weighing yourself. I have tried. Not a big success. Then my wife, from time to time, she has a sharp tongue. She said to me dryly, "Bjarte, maybe you didn't stand there long enough on the weight." Well, that would have been one kind of action. But the point is that nothing happens unless we do something, so a high focus on actions. And last but not least, a translation of what does this mean for you and me and the teams we are in. So what you see here is an integrated process running all the way from strategy via finance and into HR territory. And here, at the last step, you see an example of activating words in the book. The very first words in the Statoil book reads as follows. At Statoil, the way we deliver is as important as what we deliver. So it's not just a question of what, it's also a question of how, defined by our values, and the weighting between the two, in all consequences for your career, base pay, individual bonus, if you have that, is 50-50. Now, some companies have processes that look like this, so let me share with you some examples of how we are trying to do this differently. Here's an example of an ambition to action. You recognize the three first steps from the previous slide, and then the HR process is coming on the right-hand side. Most organizations, they have finance on top and people, so they have the opposite order. It starts with finance on top and people organization at the bottom. It used to be like that in Statoil, but we saw what happened in business review meetings. When we reviewed ambition to action, we started with finance and moved our way down. The agenda is always tight and time is always short. And always when we approach people in organization, somebody would say that, hey, we're a bit short on time. Could we maybe move that to next meeting? Next meeting, start on top with finance, work your way down, bit tight guys, maybe next meeting. There was no ill will behind, but it is not a signal to send that if you on one hand say that people in organization is important, and on the other hand, you don't have time to talk about it. So we switched the order. Now we start with people in organization. And trust me, there's always time to talk about the money. Today we have around 800 of these in the organization. That might sound a lot, but nobody has a relation to 800. You have a relation to your own and those around you. Let me use this slide to illustrate two other areas where we try to be different. It has to do with so-called alignment. How do you get this red thread throughout these? There is an easy way to do it, which finance people love. It's called cascading. It's a terrible word, by the way. Huh? It's cascading. I mean, use that if you hear that word from corporate, it sounds like somebody's going to throw a bucket of something into your head, right? Or take the word rollout. We shouldn't be surprised if it sounds like rollover if you're out there in the front line. So we need to be careful with the words we use. Cascading is about sitting at the corporate center and then simply instructing all the way down. These are your objectives, these are your KPIs, your KPI targets, and so on. And again, it's a wonderful way to get this mechanical alignment. And then finance people can add on all the numbers locally, and it matches the corporate number, and they think they can sleep well at night. Well, they can't, because very often that mechanical cascading has destroyed everything related to ownership, commitment, involvement, and then that alignment is worth nothing. So we don't do that, but we still need alignment. We create alignment through a process which we call translation. And this is more than playing with words. Translation is about any of these teams translating other ambition to actions around them, which is relevant for them. So when a team here shall make their own ambition to action, they will typically look one level up, maybe further up, maybe all the way up to corporate, maybe a bit left and right, depending on what kind of relations you have this way. And then that team would have a deep and good discussion about what does our ambition need to look like to support the ambitions and the direction of those we have a relationship to. If such a translation should go wrong, which is not the problem, by the way, but it could happen, if it should go wrong, of course the management above should do what they are paid for, but it is not the problem. One reason it's not a problem is, again, transparency. All of these ambition to actions are, with a few exceptions of share sensitive information, then all of these are open, available for all employees. There is no way to hide, no place to hide with a stupid ambition to action. Transparency as a control mechanism, very effective. That doesn't mean that we cascade. There are situations, critical situations, when that can be justified, but there should be much more the exception than the rule. And our experience is that when it is more exception than the rule, it's also more accepted when it happens. Another area where we try to be different has to do with time. We used to have annual versions of ambition to actions, so every year these teams would make a new one for next year, every autumn. It wasn't a budget process, much better, but still an annual process. In 2010, we decided to skip that. So no longer annual versions. Today, all of these teams can change whatever they want on their own ambition when there is a need for it, when something changes in their business environment. They can change strategic objectives if strategy change. They can change KPIs if these objectives change or if they simply find a better KPI. They can even change their KPI targets if these targets have lost their meaning. And lost their meaning could either mean these targets are impossible to achieve, everybody laughs about them. Those targets, they don't work. They don't inspire, they don't ignite. They have just one purpose left, which is punishment, right? Which is not that motivating. Or it could be the other way around. This target is now a piece of cake. We have to increase the ambition levels. But this is not an anarchy. We have a simple control mechanism around that. We say that if you want to change something on your ambition to action, which is big, you can do it at any time. But if it's big, you need to seek approval, one level up. If it's small, you just inform, one level up. Big or small, always make sure that you inform others affected by your changes. This is the coordination part of it, right? So much more continuous, organic, dynamic instead of these annual stunts. Targets. Why should all targets have deadline end of December? It doesn't make sense. We want more natural time horizons. Short, if there's urgency and we're able to deliver on a short deadline. Some longer, if it's more complex and takes longer time. We haven't banned end of year, end of December deadlines, but it should be more the exception than the rule. We still have still sit down once a year and talk about performance like we've done always, but that is not a problem to have an annual written on that still. We have discussions about skipping that as well, but you can combine the two. So when you have that annual talk, you would look at some targets that are delivered 3 months ago, some is still work in progress, and maybe some were finished just before that talk. Forecasting, a lot of companies going beyond budgeting, they introduce what rolling forecasting to that a core horizon. Rolling forecasting typically means that you update your forecast every quarter and you look typically always 5 quarters ahead, right? So rolling, always 5 quarters ahead. We did not go for that at Statoil because there was quite a lot of variety in the business rhythm here. I worked for some years as finance manager in the part of Statoil where we trade the oil that we produce. And for these traders, anything beyond 3 weeks is quite foggy. But I also worked also Statoil where we explore for new reserves, where we develop and build, and then 3 years is on the short side. Why should we force everybody into a fixed forecasting rhythm, same frequency, same time horizon? Doesn't make sense. So we went instead for what we call dynamic forecasting, which means that these teams, they update their forecast when stuff happens in their own business reality. Right? And they don't do it for us at corporate level. They do it for themselves in order to manage themselves. We can tap into that information when we need it on a consolidated Statoil basis. We do that from time to time. But the point is that this forecasting is not done for us, it's done for these teams. So we want, again, this is about creating conditions for great performance to take place, and we want to help businesses to manage themselves. So also one reason why it's not mandatory to have an ambition to action. Teams decide for themselves. Many teams ask us, should we have an ambition to action in our team? And our answer would be, we think this is pretty good stuff, but if you introduce it, you should do it because this is something that you feel that you and your team is being helped by in managing yourself, right? So if you don't want to use ambition to action, fine. The leadership job still has to be done. A leader still needs to talk about tomorrow and not just today. Some kind of measurement is typically needed. Some kind of action planning is typically needed. If you want to use PowerPoint, Excel, and Word, fine, your choice. We wouldn't recommend it, but your choice. It's about creating ownership. By the way, I was speaking once at the Faroe Islands, talking about this, and there was a guy coming over to me afterwards and told me a story about the finance guy and a fisherman. So there was a finance guy who met a fisherman. Don't ask me how that happened, but let's assume it happened. And then the finance guy asked the fisherman, tell me a little bit about the rhythm of your working life. Well, says the fisherman, first I'm at sea for 5 months, and then I'm home for 5 months. The finance guy, he goes completely silent. He's thinking very hard before his next question. What are you then doing the 2 last months? Something is wrong here, right? 5 plus 5 is only 10. It kind of doesn't add up. And of course something is wrong, but maybe more in the head of the finance guy than in the working rhythm of the fisherman. Lovely story. All right, let me finish off here with the holistic performance evaluation. And holistic here means two things. First of all, it's the 50-50 between the what and the how that I just talked about. And it's a bit difficult to see here. I don't know what happened. Holistic is also about when we shall assess and talk about the what we have delivered in business terms. Then first of all, that is defined by ambition to action, right? Ambition to action defines, is the basis for that performance talk. But it is not just a question of kind of reading the color of those KPIs, red and green, and then kind of conclude based on the number of red and green KPIs. That is a very dumb way of assessing performance. I mean, if we reduce performance evaluation to red and green stickers or colors in a performance, then the only qualification you need as a manager to do performance evaluation is two things. First of all, you must, of course, be able to count, and you can't be colorblind. I wouldn't pass. I can count, but I'm colorblind. But the reason why we can't dumb it down like this is that it has to do with KPIs. I've been working with KPIs for more than 20 years, balance scorecards. I recall when this stuff came to Europe, Kaplan Norton, I was extremely fascinated with this new concept of balance scorecard, especially these KPIs that would come and tell us everything that we hadn't understood about the business we were into. I thought KPIs would solve it all. I spent many, many years searching for that perfect KPI. I'm a stubborn person. I was hunting and hunting, but now I've given up. I've given up the hunt for a perfect KPI simply because it doesn't exist. These are, again, indicators. They're trying to indicate that we are moving towards something, but they are not necessarily telling the full truth. There is a reason why they are called key performance indicators, KPIs. They are not called KPTs, key performance truths. They are called key performance indicators. Albert Einstein, not everything that counts can be counted. And not everything that can be counted counts. And don't misunderstand me, I mean, measurement is still an important part of our model, but measurement alone can be very dangerous. And measurement can be a good servant, but as a master, measurement can be a disaster. And we've seen some examples of that. So that is why we can start with measuring. We can start counting red and green KPIs, but then we have to take off our measuring glasses and look at what measurement didn't pick up. We have to pressure test measurement before we conclude. We do that through 5 simple questions. Yes, I see that your KPI was great. Have we really moved towards those strategic objectives when we look at what measurement didn't pick up? How ambitious were those targets? If there was a team that really stretched, set themselves a target up here, maybe inspired by someone else, and didn't completely make it, color of the KPI, red, maybe yellow, not green, then you had this other team, very good at lowballing, gaming, oh, it's so difficult. Getting away with the target here, performing here, wow, green KPI. Take away those targets, which team performed best? The first team performed best, even if the KPI wasn't green. Has there been significant changes in assumptions that we should take into account? Headwind, tailwind, was there an earthquake in Japan that made things a bit more difficult? Competitor going bankrupt, making that target a piece of cake? And so on. We shouldn't take everything into account, but we need to apply common sense, hindsight insights on top of the measurement before we can conclude. You probably can't see it, but there is we do have a performance rating on a scale from 1 to 5 in both dimensions. Personally, I'm not a big fan of performance rating. I think it dumps down the whole performance talk, but it is less of a problem here because we have this holistic vision. Anyway, the outcome of that talk is the basis for development plan for all employees. It's the basis for your base pay development, and it is the basis for individual bonus for those on individual bonus. So again, I'm not a big fan of individual bonuses, but again, by having this holistic evaluation, we kind of take the worst effects of it. I I've been on those schemes for the last 20 years. I enjoy the money, but it is not what drives me. And most of my colleagues are actually saying very much the same. All right, so to conclude, going back to the traffic metaphor, I hope you've seen that. I haven't had time to talk about all of this, but what we are doing, this journey we have been on, has very much been about changing the whole sentiment around how we think about these issues, from the traditional performance management thinking of the traffic light into creating conditions for great performance to take place, in along with the roundabout metaphor. When it comes to cost consciousness, event-driven translation, more relative KPIs, and transparency. This is an attempt to simplify. The management processes here are simpler, but simple is not the same as easy, and from a leadership point of view, this is more challenging. That is why we have leaders who struggle with this. We have leaders, some who still long back to the old days. And you know, some of those leaders, not many, but some of them, are managers who don't like to make decisions. And if you don't like to make decisions, a detailed annual budget is wonderful, because then somebody has made those decisions for you, right? And if those, some of those are unpopular decisions, you even have someone to blame. So traditional budgeting is wonderful, again, if you don't like to make decisions. Right, this is what I wanted to share with you. I hope there's time for a few questions. If you want to contact me later on, feel free to do that on these coordinates. If you want to follow me on Twitter, I only tweet about beyond budgeting, nothing else. There's no dogs and no children, no nothing. If you're even more interested, there is something called the Beyond Budgeting Roundtable. And this is our homepage. It's the global network of companies interested in this stuff. And if you want to attend one of our meetings, you're more than welcome as a guest, free of charge and without any commitments. We typically meet on a European basis in London. The next meeting is sometimes mid-October. You find the details on the website. And if you're even more interested, what you just heard was the very short version of Beyond Budgeting and the Statoil Journey. This is the long version. I wrote this book not just about what we did at Statoil, but also in another company called Borealis back in the mid-90s, more about problems and more about implementation advice, which I didn't have time to talk about here. If you should be interested in this book, let me share with you that I've just finalized a radically updated second edition, which will be published in the US July 18. So, if you're interested, maybe you want to wait. This edition is even better than the first one. All right.